Good morning once again and hello. Welcome back to another lesson brought to you by Smart Caps, proudly sponsored by the Department of Basic Education, VT Tech, and VT Africa Holdings. We look into the introduction of the periodic table. At grade 7 level, we are going to introduce the periodic table as it is important to us. It introduces how elements are tabled or are arranged in order, in groupings. The periodic table is a classification system that puts together all the elements that we have or have found, discovered, into a table or into some order. And that order is represented by a table called the periodic table. This periodic table was found or was proposed by our Russian scientist Dmitry Mendeleev in 1872. It puts together elements that we have discovered and found into a table and in line. So, what are elements? Elements are as an element is a substance that cannot be broken down. And we discussed this in the previous lesson where we said when we have a substance such as water, this can be broken down into hydrogens, there are two of them, and oxygen. So our H2O can be broken down, making it not a pure substance, but a substance made up of three atoms or three elements. When looking at another element, such as magnesium is Mg and it's just magnesium, so it cannot be broken down further. So these elements that we find that are pure, such as iron. Iron is an element and it's pure. It is symbolized or it is represented in the periodic table in the form of it will have a particular name. It will have a unique name. And it will have other two labels that will make it unique, such that we do not confuse it with other elements. So an element is unique, it's independent and it's on its own. It occurs on its own and it's unique. So we represent it and symbolize it uniquely by a symbol. This is iron. It will have a particular label or name or symbol. Attached to it that will be put into the periodic table. We use symbols in order to represent those elements, right? These symbols are important. It would be such a tedious job. It would be such a hard job to be writing down all elements in their full names. So we simplify it or abbreviate it using symbols. And each element will have a unique symbol attached to it. It's called a chemical symbol representing the element. Elements in our periodic table will also have a particular atomic number attached to it. As to chemical symbols and elements, we'll discuss it further in this particular. Let's look into chemical symbols. Here in the table, we have zinc, which is a metal. Zinc is represented by the symbol Zn. and you find it in the periodic table. In the periodic table, we do not write it as zinc, but we write it as the symbol Zn, right? So, how do we now come to understanding how these symbols were put together, or help us memorizing or knowing these symbols attached to these elements? So how we go about it is such that we will have an element such as nitrogen, and the first letter of the element will be the symbol for that element, right? Nitrogen will have symbol N. Nitrogen will have symbol N. Nitrogen symbol N. Let's look at oxygen. Oxygen will have symbol O. Here we are, where we have nitrogen and oxygen having symbols N. But what happens when we have an element, two elements having starting with alphabet? So we have two elements starting with the same alphabet. Let's look at carbon and chlorine. They both start with the symbol, right? So what happens is carbon has been assigned symbol C, while chlorine has been assigned symbol Cl, such that it is unique to each element, such that it is different and easily to identify. So carbon will have symbol C, whilst chlorine has symbol C. Calcium, also starting with symbol C, but also starting with alphabet C, but will have a symbol Ca, right? This is such that it can be identified. It can be easier to know what we are talking about. We cannot be having C for all calcium, carbon, and chlorine. How will we know as to what we are talking about? So we will assign a second letter to the element such that it is different. Calcium being Ca, chlorine being Cl. The second alphabet in our symbol for the element will have a lowercase alphabet, whilst the first alphabet will always be an uppercase, right? But looking at the table, we see elements such as lead, iron, gold, copper, sodium, tin, and so on and so forth, potassium, having what? A symbol that is not the case or does not connect to what I've just discussed as to the element having the first letter being the symbol. Why is this so? The Na from sodium, the symbol for Na from sodium comes from the Latin name for sodium, right, which is natrium. Comes from the Latin name for sodium, which is natrium, and has symbol Na. This is only because in the early stages, in the 1800s, when we were still tabulating as scientists the periodic table, we came to see, we were learning or understanding in Latin. Language then used was Latin. So most of these elements, such as sodium, which were initially discovered, had their names in Latin, such as sodium having a Latin name of natrium. A Latin name of natrium meaning they took the first letter, the first alphabet, right, which is N, but N was already assigned to nitrogen, meaning it has to have a second letter, lowercase, to identify it, which is Na. And this is why such elements such as sodium have symbols that do not conform to the standard of having the symbol of the element being the first letter of the element. Elements such as gold, copper, iron were discovered and labeled in Latin, right? They were labeled in Latin, and labeling them in Latin meant that the symbol would come out as the first letter of the word in capital, and the second one should the first letter be assigned to another symbol already. So looking at some simple rules to remember when using chemical symbols is that every element has its own unique symbol, right? The symbol is the first letter of that, usually. The first letter of that element, or the first letter of the element, and sometimes the second letter, such as in the case of helium, where H was already assigned to hydrogen, and helium needing a differentiation from hydrogen such that we put E there, and hydrogen is now different from helium by symbol. Some elements or symbols come from their Latin names, as already discussed. So we looked at the chemical symbol. Well, now we need to look at the atomic number. All you need to know is our elements in the periodic table will be represented like this, where we have the name of the element, right? We have the symbol of the element, right? And lastly, which is in your case, needing to know what we call the atomic number. The atomic number. So further discuss what the atomic number is, right? So the atomic number is the number of protons there are in each atom of this element. What am I talking about? So, in order for us to understand this better, we need to think of it this way. All matter that we find in the universe are made up of small particles called atoms. This includes elements as well. Elements are made up of small atoms. So atoms of a particular element will be identical. They will be exactly the same, right? Once you have an atom being different from another, it then means it is representing a separate element. When they are the same, they are representing the same element. Element. Atoms we'll look into further in grade 8. But for now, in order for us to understand what the atomic number is, we need to understand what atoms are. And I'll briefly discuss what atoms are. So atoms, small particles make the larger whole, making up an element. So an atom represented by Let's represent it like that. If that's our atom, it will have a nucleus of neutrons and protons. Don't know about it too much, where the protons and the neutrons and the electrons will be the same number, right? So each element will have the same number of atoms, each element will have the same number of protons, electrons, and neutrons in its atom, right? Think of atoms as building blocks. When we're doing life and living, we introduce the concept of a cell. So think of it as the building block that make up the element. So it will have the same number of protons, neutrons, and electrons. So each element will have the same number of protons, neutrons, and electrons. So the atomic number will be the number of protons there are in that atom. So the number of protons there are in that atom will represent the atomic number, right? For now, do not worry too much about this. We will discuss the concept of an atom in grade 8. For you, for now to know, is that elements are made up of, or all matter are made up of, particles called atoms. So with elements, them being pure substances, it means all the atoms making up that element will be the same, right? And if it is a mixture, it will have different substances to it, meaning it will have different atoms to it. But if it is an element, it will be pure. It will be a pure substance having this very same atoms to it. So the atomic number will be the number of protons inside each atom of an element. Let's go back to a periodic table. Now you understand what an atom is. You understand what an atomic number is. Let's go back to our atomic number. So atomic number, we understand to be the number of protons there are in an element. Because it is the number of atoms there are in an atom, and all atoms will be the same for each element, we will simply say, refer to the atomic number as the number of protons there are in that element, all right? Or the number of protons there are in the atoms of that element. So let's go back to our periodic table. Originally, the periodic table designed by Mendeleev at the time is very different from the one we have today. The one we have today is far more developed as we find more and more elements, as we discover more and more elements, right? Looking at this, how Mendeleev, the Russian scientist that designed or proposed the structure of the periodic table, he compiled the atoms that he had found at the time, right? He said, okay, how am I going to rank these? He ranked them in order increasing atomic mass. He said, okay, the first one will be the one with the least atomic mass, and the last one will be the one with the highest atomic mass, right? After listing them like that, he grouped them to say we'll have particular groups. Why have particular groups? This is because in experiments, we found that some elements have similar properties, right? We discussed what properties are when we were looking at acids and bases. So these elements having similar properties, we chose to group them together and put them in particular classes or particular groups to say, let's put these here and let's have those there, right? But still having them in the order of increasing atomic mass. So this is the advanced or the recent periodic table that we have, and it looks like this, right? It still has groupings, right? It still has groupings, and these groupings are in such that the elements have similar properties. They behave the same in some shape or form, right? These groupings are in rows and columns, right? In rows and columns, as you can see. So let's look at these. What do we mean by these properties? What do we mean by these groupings looking the same and being the same? Let's look at these different elements that I have placed here on the board, and let's look at what it means to have similar properties or different properties. When looking at on the board, we have aluminium foil, carbon, sulfur, chlorine, copper, and bromine, right? Looking at aluminium, aluminium is rather shiny, is it not? It's rather shiny. Chlorine is a gas at room temperature. Copper is a metal and is also shiny, relatively. And is, what else? It's a metal, right? And many other things. Carbon, sulfur, bromine. Looking at bromine, bromine is clearly liquid. Sulfur is clearly a solid, but not a metal, right? And is it as shiny? No, it is not as shiny as other metals, right? Let's look at other properties that we can assign to these. When making or grouping these, we look at properties that they have, and that's when we say, okay, these should be grouped together in this particular part of the periodic table. Because of these properties, these elements should be grouped in a separate part of the periodic table. So we have elements that are shiny, right? Such as aluminium and copper. We have properties that are lustrous. We have properties that are dull, right? Looking at sulfur on the board or carbon on the board, they're rather not as shiny as copper and aluminium. They're rather dull. We have malleable, ductile, those that can conduct electricity. Those that can conduct heat, right? Those that are solids at room temperature, those that inhibit, or as discussed in our previous lesson, insulate, right? So because of these properties, we will group these elements in a particular way in the periodic table, right? And we use these properties that they have to group them. So how do the groupings go about? For our level grade 7, we'll look into three groupings: metals, non-metals, and semi-metals or metalloids. We know what metals are, and we know what they can do for us. Metals, we know them to be having what? We know metals to be shiny. We know metals to be lustrous. We know metals to be malleable. Some metals are ductile, some are not. But we know metals to be having these, right? We know metals, we use metals in conducting electricity. We use metals in conducting, right? We know that when you're having a steel metal and you put it in fire, it will or allow heat to travel through it better than if you put wood in there, right? And these are the properties. So we have metals, we have metals, we have non-metals, and we have semi-metals, right? We know that metals have particular properties and they're grouped together, as you see. Here are our metals represented in red. And we've grouped them together. And in grouping them together, we still maintain that increase in what? In atomic mass. Because that's how, that was the proposed way to list them by our famous scientist Dmitri Mendeleev, right? So we still have our metals grouped together. We still have our non-metals grouped together, right? We still have our non-metals grouped together, and we have our semi-metals grouped together. There are our semi-metals, and not so many of them, right? What are semi-metals, you may ask? So we know what metals are. We know what non-metals are, right? What are semi-metals or metalloids? Well, metalloids are substances or elements that cannot simply be put as metals or non-metals. What happens is they have both properties of metals and they will have also properties of non-metals. What do I mean? I mean, substances such as selenium will be at room temperature, shiny, looking like a metal, right? But at the same time, they are not as strong as metals. They are pretty brittle. When conducting a test on these, if you drop it from a great height, it will shatter, right? And we do not know metals to do that. Metals, and if trying to bend it, it will not break, but it will bend. That's how we know metals to be. So if it is brittle and breaks upon bending it, we still classify it as a metal? It's not quite. It would be, because it breaks, it would qualify as a non-metal, but it already has some qualities of a metal. So where does it fall? It falls under semi-metals or metalloids. Semi-metal. Right? It's a semi-metal or metalloid. And as we continue further with science in other grades, we'll look at more properties that allow for us to have these particular groupings, right? But for our grade 7, it is for us to know that we have these three groups in our periodic table of our metal, of our non-metals, and a small group there for our semi-metals, right? And that is all the time we have to. Please do remember, I will be having an assessment on these as we continue the periodic table. This is only an introduction to the periodic table. I will be having an assessment on these such that we understand and clear out all misconceptions.